Hello and welcome to the final instalment of IndieApril for this year, in which I'm going to talk about the most recent, or the last book that I released in 2020, called Secure the Shadow. Beautiful artwork there by Velula Kesso. It's really, really a very pretty looking book. This particular story, we're going to be talking about a lot of adult themes, including suicide and premature death. So, you know, if you don't want to listen to this, just skip over it, go to another video. But if you're going to stick around, now you know. So, what's this book about? This book is a return to historical fiction. It switches times, and it switches between, mostly switches between Victorian England or Victorian Bristol and modern day Gloucester. So, the West Country in England. You'll have to forgive me, I'm losing my voice a little bit at the moment. I've got rainy season allergies, but I've also got mutzig, so hopefully that will help to lubricate my voice and we can get to the end of this. So, it began with a phone call that I received many years ago now, probably about 10 years ago or so. I'd returned from Rwanda the first time around, and I was working as a charity consultant in the UK. Part of my job was that I would assist charities who were looking to get through charity registration, because there's a lot of paperwork involved in that. So that's mostly what I was doing. And one day I got a phone call. And I got a phone call from an organisation with a very, very long name, which I won't repeat, but it was a long name. They could probably have done with an abbreviation, possibly an acronym. But what they did was they sent volunteers into hospitals free of charge to take photographs of stillbirths. So families who had had a child who had been stillborn or had died shortly after birth, and they took photographs for the family. And it was a very interesting thing to listen to, because, you know, this wasn't something that many of the families knew that you could do, but the hospital staff knew, and they would often, you know, let the families know that this service was available and, you know, suggest that they have the photographs taken, even if they never want those photographs, if they don't want them in the future, they don't have to receive them. But as they explained, you know, it's such a shock of circumstance at that moment that photographs are usually the last thing that anybody thinks to take. But the thing that many families regret not having later down the line, and wishing that they had something to remember their child by in that respect. And the photographs, there are some photographs on the website, and they're really, really very beautiful. They're like any newborn photograph, you know, mother, father, family. And very, very beautiful, very, very touching photographs. And I found it very, very interesting, because for me, I'd heard of, you know, I knew about post-mortem photographs. I'm British, you know, Victorian England was very well known for that. Maybe you've seen the adaptation of Turning of the Screw, the film with Nicole Kidman called The Others, where they go into post-mortem photographs in that a bit. And so, you know, I knew of post-mortem photographs and memento mori, but I knew of it as something that had happened in the past, and I didn't realise that it was still something that was going on. But, you know, when they explained it to me, it made perfect sense. It was very logical. Because, you know, I thought it was, that was really where the story began, was that imagining what it must be like for a mother who has gone through everything that every other mother went through, all of the steps of pregnancy and all of that, but got to the end and then couldn't talk about it, you know, because most women who have had children, that's what you hear all the time, you know, breastfeeding tips, you know, sleeping tips, teething tips, the ins and outs of giving birth. And, you know, for the mother whose child didn't live, I think that's a very different experience, and probably quite an isolating one. And so to have that photograph, I think, is a very natural thing to have, and to want to have. And I kind of started off thinking about it like that, you know, thinking, oh, okay, so, you know, post-mortem photographs, sorry, fruit fly, post-mortem photographs are still something that are being taken now, and they were very, very popular in Victorian England. And I started to look into this a little bit and to think about it a bit more. And I felt like there was a story there about how we view death, and what role photographs have got in that and in history. And I stumbled across, I don't know if YouTube's going to completely censor me even for saying the word here, but there is a video on YouTube called The Poignancy of Old Pornography by I think it's called the school of life, something like that. I'll link to it below. Even if you're not interested in pornography, it's a really interesting video to go and watch, because it really delves into our relationship with our photographs. And, you know, I always remember when I was a kid, there was a Dove advert for, I'm going to go with deodorant or soap, and it was this really amazing advert where there were these kids who were like showing off in front of the camera, you know, sort of dancing and showing off in front of the camera. And then as the women aged, they started to shy away. They got to their teenage years and they're sort of, you know, don't take a photograph of me. And it just had that line, you know, when did you stop thinking you were beautiful? And I find that quite a profound concept. And one thing that I get in the book here is, you know, the photographs remain the same throughout our lives, but the way that we feel about those photographs change. It's like, you know, a lot of people, they look at photographs of when they were teenagers that they hated having taken of them. And then when they get to sort of my age in their 40s, you know, you're sort of looking back at it going, oh, actually, I didn't look too bad, you know? And so I found that very interesting, because all of my books, I think, deal with the concept of mortality and time and the ticking and the passing of time. Children of Lear probably more than any of the others, but I have always found that a very interesting subject, and one that I think most of us grapple with throughout our lives, the meaning of life and time and existence. And so that's what a lot of my books are about. But this one just really grabbed my attention, because the more I started to research, the more I had to start to question my acceptance of how we memorialize death, and especially with photographs. So, you know, the idea of having a photograph of a stillborn, you know, to remember that child by, and to say, you know, this child existed, they were mine. That I find very understandable. And then we start getting on to some other cases. So one gentleman who, especially around burial rites, so one gentleman was buried on his motorbike in a glass case lowered into the ground. And I sort of thought, oh goodness, it was a little bit like taxidermy. So then there was a Puerto Rican guy called Christopher Rivera Amaro, and he died quite prematurely. He was a young man and he loved boxing. And I'm not going to put the picture up here, but you can check the spelling in the subtitles and go and look it up if you like to. But his family wanted to commemorate his love of boxing. They hired the local town hall, set up a boxing ring, and had his body dressed up and made up to look like he was alive, you know, posed in his boxing silks. And his friends and family are literally there taking photographs on their phone with Christopher post-mortem. And that fascinated me, that concept. And the reason it fascinated me, because my initial reaction was sort of a, not sure about that, feel a bit uncomfortable. And I sat with it for a while and I looked at it and I thought, actually, you know what, that's kind of a nice thing to do. You know, that they were really celebrating in death what he had loved in life. I don't know. It was so far removed from what we would know in the UK. But when you look into it, there are a few other cases like this. One guy who was dressed up as the Green Lantern, which was his favourite comic character, and he was dressed up and his family were there with him taking photographs. I think, again, he was a Puerto Rican guy. But I just found it very, very interesting, because that in itself is something the Victorians never did and something I became very, very good at. So there's a game that two characters play in this book called Dead or Alive. And I just threw it in there and then I became quite good at playing it. So Dead or Alive is where you find Victorian post-mortem photographs and you have to guess whether or not they're real post-mortem photographs or whether they're not, because there's a huge number of photographs that are just a bit creepy. And because they're a bit creepy, people say, oh, the people in here are dead. Well, they weren't dead. And there are a few little ways that you can tell. So I learned whilst writing the book what to look for. So there's many giveaways. So one of them's the clothing is, you know, usually if it's a post-mortem photograph, the people in the photograph are dressed in mourning clothes. So, you know, if you see a woman sitting there in a shawl and a normal dress with a child on her lap sleeping, that child is probably alive. If she's not wearing black, the child is probably alive. But it was a very, very common thing in Victorian era to pose children as though they were sleeping, and, you know, sometimes adults, because the exposure time on a camera was extremely long. It could be over a minute, you know, where you just have to sit there absolutely still. And if you moved during that minute and a half, those 2 minutes, depending on how much light you had, if you moved at all, that photograph will blur and you'd have to start again. So especially with children who are quite known for running around and, you know, being quite boisterous, the safest way to photograph them was in a sleeping position or whilst they were asleep, because they were less likely to move and destroy the photograph. So, I mean, that's a difficult one for us to comprehend nowadays, because we've all got phone cameras, digital cameras. You literally tap a button and it's done instantly. Or sometimes you can take hundreds of photographs in the space of a second. But back then, you couldn't. And, you know, and photographs back then, if they were a daguerreotype, tin type, they were one of a kind. You could never reproduce that picture. So you had to make sure you couldn't touch it up. You had to make sure that it was right the first time around. So there's that. A lot of people think that it's a post-mortem or a death photograph if they see a little piece of metal around the head. There's sometimes a pole and a piece of metal at the back of the head. And I always used to think that that meant it was propping up a corpse. But it's not. Again, exactly the same reasoning is living people move. A corpse doesn't move. So you don't need to hold a corpse in place, but you need to hold a living person in place. So usually if you see that, usually it's going to be a living person. And also the Victorians weren't so big on posing dead people as though they were living. They didn't do a Christopher. They didn't dress him up in his boxing silks as though he was still alive. You know, post-mortem photographs were usually a fairly tasteful last memory of a dead person. And, you know, it was usually fairly obvious that they were deceased. Another good one is, you know, if the people in the photograph are even slightly blurred, unlikely to be dead. There's a very sort of, I'm going to say famous, but a well-circulated post-mortem photograph where it looks like the mother and father on the bed with their daughter in the middle. And it's absolutely crystal clear that it's the daughter who's dead, because the mother and father are ever so slightly blurred because they're breathing. And even that was enough to disrupt the photograph slightly, whereas the daughter in the middle is absolutely crystal clear because she didn't move at all. So those are ways to tell, if you ever want to play the game, alive or dead. There's also some back to that point about the sleeping children, Lewis Carroll, who wrote, Alice in Wonderland, it was during this research that I found out what a creepy dude he was. There's one particular photograph that is widely circulated as being a post-mortem photograph. So it's supposed to be a dead child lying on a couch. But the more that you look into that, it appears that that might have been Alice Liddell. So the original Alice in Wonderland, photographed by Lewis Carroll. And when you look at it, he actually has a bit of a penchant for photographing young children looking like they've passed out. Now, yeah, you could argue that, you know, well, you had a long exposure chart time. It was better that, you know, they stayed still. But still, some of the way that they're posed is, I mean, it's questionable. And people say, oh, well, it's questionable now, but it wasn't in the innocence of the time. Not everybody was totally comfortable with what he was doing, even back then. So yeah, that was a learning curve. That was something I learned. What else? I'm going to carry on with the macabre here. I became a little bit obsessed with the story of Evelyn McHale. So Evelyn McHale committed suicide by jumping from the Empire State Building. And I will just quickly read. I don't usually read from my books because I don't enjoy doing that out loud. But I will just read the paragraph on Evelyn McHale here. So, on the 1st of May, 1947, Evelyn McHale, a bookkeeper from Berkeley, California, neatly folded her coat, placed it on a wall, and threw herself from the 86th floor of the Empire State Building. Her body landed on top of a Cadillac limousine parked on 34th Street. In a cafe across the road was a young photography student named Robert Wiles. Despite the 1,040-foot fall, Evelyn landed on her back with a strangely peaceful expression, the metal roof of the car folding about her like water. Beneath her coat, they found a suicide note. The opening line read, "I don't want anyone in or out of my family to see any part of me." Yet the image of her body became one of the most iconic in the history of photography. The whole world saw every part of her. It was a very strange story, a very sad and tragic story, but an ironic one that, you know, I mean, she clearly had imagined what that sort of fall would do to her body. She hadn't imagined what the limousine would do to her body, and that there would be a photography student literally in the cafe across the road with his camera at that time. And I mean, you had to really work to take a photograph back then. You know, it wasn't a point and click affair. You had to work. And so, I mean, it has been referred to as the most beautiful suicide photograph. And that kind of raises the very uncomfortable question of how many suicide photographs are there? You know, who goes around collecting those? I'm sure there must be somebody, but I don't really want to think about it. So, yeah, that was an interesting thing to read about. You know, what a dramatic way to go out. And that kind of continued to fuel this strange link through history about photographing dead people. So, you know, while sort of standing there with his camera going, oh, a body, I think I'll photograph that, you know, which almost seems distasteful, but resulted in one of the most iconic and beautiful pictures. It really is like a work of art. And, you know, she was referred to as Sleeping Beauty for a long time. It was, What a way to land. Anyway, whereas back in Victorian ages, people were, you know, calling the local photographers saying, oh yeah, granddad's dead, could you come and take a photograph of him? And then you move forward to modern times where this hospital is calling in volunteers to take the photographs in case the family want a memento and want that photograph later on. And like I said, they didn't have to have it, but at that moment they didn't think to call the local photographer because it is considered so distasteful, really, in modern society. So we've gone from it being sort of a normal thing to want to take a last reminder of your loved one to then being something people still desperately want but don't know that they want and wouldn't ask for because you've kind of been told that that's not something that you do. But we know that it's something that you do because during this research, the next evolution of that was that there was a huge rise in people taking photographs of their dead family because everybody now has got their own camera. And apparently it's become very, very common when people, you know, die or at funerals, if it's an open casket, to take photographs again. So it seems like there has always been this desire to do so and always been this desire to have that picture. But, you know, we've been told that we mustn't and that we shouldn't and that you shouldn't really want that because that makes you a bit weird. But clearly it's a very human desire. Although there were some very strange... there were some very strange selfies. Like, there was one lady there and there was an elderly woman who appeared to have, you know, deceased in the background, and this woman in the pink sort of going on like that in the foreground. And you're, like, sitting there thinking, well, you don't even... Is that her grandmother? Because it could be anybody at that point. Was she just walking through a hospital and she saw a corpse and she thought, oh, yeah, that'd be a cool thing to take a photograph with, you know? Who knows? People are strange. People are weird. And I'm weird because I went off and researched all this and wrote a book about it. So, but I think it's fascinating. For me, I tend not to start from a point of revulsion or... I try to take a morality out of it a little bit, and just, you know, you can be disgusted by it or you can be in favour of it, but either way, it happens. So I'm more interested in why it happens. What are we interested in there? Why do we want to spend that time looking at death? And I've got my own theories on it. You know, I mean, years ago, I witnessed a very violent accidental death, and the body was taken away very quickly. And I felt like I hadn't had enough time to really absorb what had happened. And that my short vision of having seen what happened was so graphic that that's what imprinted on my mind. And I had a very hard time getting over it, because I couldn't see that person in any other state than that. And I kind of feel like if I'd had a moment to go and sit with the body, maybe after it had been cleaned up and you know, sat there and actually looked, then I might have recovered from that a little bit quicker. I remember I did see my Nana when she was laid out, and I saw a friend in childhood when they were laid out. And, you know, I think when you come face to face with an actual dead body in a not a mortuary, but in a funeral home, it's undeniable that the person that you knew was gone. You know, you can't sit there with a corpse and say, oh yes, that's the same person I used to know. You know, that it's a finalizer that in some ways, if it's done well, allows you to let go and say, right, well, they're not here anymore, and closure. You know, it's a very American word, closure. We don't tend to use it in Britain, but yeah, it's got a place. I understand the word closure. So yeah, whereas I didn't feel like I had that with the young man who died, because all I saw was the very graphic way in which he died, and I didn't you know, I didn't see anything after that. So I felt like there wasn't really that closure. There wasn't that finality. Yeah, maybe I'll talk about that another time. But yeah, so I find the whole concept of how we cope with death and how we view death and how we look at it and how that's changed over the ages has been very interesting. One thing I Secure the Shadow is one of the first advertising slogans ever made. And Secure the Shadow is secure the shadow ere the substance fades. So get a picture of it before it disappears, before it's too late. And that was a favoured advertising slogan of photographers. And it really sort of linked in with the idea of post-mortem photographs. So take a picture of your loved ones before it's too late, be they dead or alive. And I have to admit, I really wasn't interested in photography. I was interested in the subject of post-mortem photography, memento mori, but not really the ins and outs of photography. I didn't think I was anyway. You know, I quite like computers. I'm interested in how they work, but not hugely. I really like, you know, cars, motorbikes. Quite interested in how they work. Love pianos, figured out how they work, take them apart, put them back together again. Photographs just wasn't really a process that I was that interested in. But the reason I got interested in it is because I wanted to know how they did the spirit photographs. So again, Victorian England, there was a huge phase of spirit photographs where it looks like there's a living person with a ghost behind them. And I wanted to know technically, how do you do that? And you can only really understand how you do that if you understand the process of how old photographs, daguerreotypes and tintypes were actually made. So I watched a lot. I watched a lot of YouTube videos about that, and some people on there were really, really kind. You know, I'd ask questions and they'd get back to me. There's a guy called Mike Robinson at Century Darkroom, and he was instrumentally brilliant and so patient. He gave me a whole hour of his time just talking me through it. And I still feel bad now because I tried my hardest to put it into words, what I was seeing, and I'm still not sure if I did it quite justice or if I really messed up. I think I got it right, but he was so kind. And apparently he worked on, I think he might have worked on Crimson Peak, because there's a scene in Crimson Peak where the optometrist, sorry, what's his name? McMichael is explaining to Edie how photography works, and then trying to show her these spirit photographs and saying, you know, there's no way this could be faked. You know, how could you do that? You know, that it's impossible. But actually it's really quite easy to do, as I found out. So that also makes it into here, the spirit photography. And I learned a lot from that, and I actually came to enjoy how the old photographs were made. I didn't think that I was that interested in the technicality of it, but when you really look at it, it's like magic, because like I said before, daguerreotypes and tintypes, there was no negative, so you could never reproduce it. That one photograph was all that there would ever be. And in a way, it's kind of like magic, you know, summoning the dark and the light out of nothingness, just having a blank piece of paper. It's a conjuring trick. And that's when I got interested, because I like stories of conjuring tricks and magic and sleight of hand and trickery. And it's quite good. So, yeah. This book, like I say, it switches between the past and the present. I struggled a little bit because one of the stories has a happy ending and one of the stories does not have such a happy ending. And it was quite difficult because, you know, beta readers and my friends and people who were reading it, I knew that they really wanted that happy ending for the second character. And it was a very difficult one for me because the story hadn't quite gone where I'd expected it to go. But at the same point, I didn't feel it would have been truthful to write, you know, that character's ending in any other way. Not to give it away, it's not horrifically awful, but it's not the happy ending either. But I felt I couldn't change that. I felt like for her to be sincerely, authentically a living, breathing character, her story had to go the way it went. And it's a difficult one. There are times when you think, should I go back and rewrite something? But I guarantee you, as a writer, when you try to write the ending that wasn't meant to be, the book isn't right. It just doesn't fit. And I think sometimes the sadder endings are the more memorable ones, the things that we learn more from. I don't know. I'm not somebody who often writes very happy endings. There have been a few. I've got better over the years. There's been one or two happy endings. But I prefer a truthful ending. I prefer something that feels authentic and genuine. So I have to admit, this book I found difficult to write. It's not. I think it's actually I think it's better than I often give it credit for. You know, I go back and I read occasionally and I think, you know what? No, it's written well. You did okay with that. I think it's because it was a difficult one to write. It was a lot of research. And at times I didn't always know where the characters were going to end up. Whereas other books like Children of Lear and especially Rosie Hours and Anger Reachner, they just fell out of me. You know, they were easy books to write. They just, poof, they just went. Whereas this one I'd say is good, but it's good because I worked at it. I did have to work on it. But anyway, I'm going to leave it there and I'm going to leave it by saying thank you very much for joining me for Indie April. I know I have waffled on all month about the different books that I've written and the inspiration for those books and why I wrote them and what I thought about them. I don't know if it's interesting or not to listen to an author talk about their work. I don't know if you have read the book, if it adds something or if it takes something away, I'm not sure. I quite like watching authors talk about their work, but I don't know if that's like reader's curiosity or professional curiosity. but I do enjoy listening to authors talk about their work and the inspirations behind it. So yeah, I'm going to leave it there. And I won't be talking about my books now for a little bit because I'm going on my travels. But yeah, let me know if you've read anything I've written and let me know what you're writing below and what the inspiration was.